creo. Seems like we always have this problem with my guitar. It wouldn't go through either. No, I mean, like, when I turn it on, I don't have a battery.
Good morning. It's a shame nobody likes each other. Let's try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is always great to be gathered among the saints. So speaking of, I'm going to go through a couple of announcements. VBS, June 23rd through 27th. We need volunteers, but this is open to anybody in the community who wants to bring their kids in and things like that, but we need volunteers. By the way, we need volunteers, and in case I haven't mentioned it, we need volunteers.
I'll be a volunteer.
You're really good at, maybe with the skit part, we'll talk. All right, but we would love for you to do that. Also, camp is coming up. The age ranges are from second grade all the way through high school, not all at once. We've got 3 weeks of camp. The information's in the bulletin if you look at the back. Something we're going to do, I'd like to also announce, is several of the churches, we've begun gathering together all the preachers, and we want to represent the church in our community. And so something we're going to try and do monthly, if we're able to, is have a monthly gathering just for prayer over our schools, over our community, over just the various needs we have. We're going to be doing that, our very first one, and we're going to do it in a public place. Thank you to those who helped set that up. We're going to be meeting at the municipal building on the 23rd of April. That's a Tuesday at 7 p.m. We'd like as many to come as possible. We're going to gather together and pray. I'm a firm believer in prayer. God told Solomon at the dedication of the temple, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, if they seek my face and turn from their evil ways, I will hear them from heaven, I will forgive them, I will heal their land." I think about that all the time. I mean, why aren't we seeing healing in our land? It's because we haven't humbled ourselves yet. And it takes a lot of humility to go before God, doesn't it? We know He sees everything, but sometimes we don't like going to Him because either A, I can handle it myself, which I can't, or B, my problem's too big or too small for God. But what's too big or too small for God? So let's gather together with like-minded believers in Christ and get together and pray on the 23rd. Next week, and you know, I'm going to go through a couple other things, but next week, Olivia Turner, I'm just going to say this real quick. The purpose of the church is not to gather water. It's to be rivers of living water. And so, you know, we know that there's people always coming in and out of the church. Our goal is to send people out, and I'm just proud. I'd like to have any credit for this, but as of this month, I've only been here 5 years, so I knew her like 1 year before she went to college. But I'm proud of the fact that this church is still sending people out. Olivia Turner is going on a missions internship to Dublin, Ireland. She had a really good connection there, and she'll be taking about 10 minutes next week to give us a presentation. And you know, I know we've asked a lot with love offerings, but if you're willing and if you're able to help send her out, we're going to have a love offering next week to help her raise funds, because missionaries, that's how they do it, they raise funds. And so let's encourage her in that, if you will, and invite somebody to come see. That's that's what Jesus' disciples did when they brought people in, come and see. That's what I think we need to do as well. So be in prayer over that. Just anything we could do to help. And And let's also be in prayer, because we have various things where we're training up people in this church to go out. Be in prayer for more young people to be ministry-minded that we can continue to send out. Allen's Sunday night group will start tonight, meeting at the church at 6 p.m. So if you're part of that, both groups will be combined there. We've got a Bible study in the fellowship hall. That's what I mean in there. It's not going to be in the baptistry, I promise. We'll all be, or they'll all be in the fellowship hall. I've got a group that meets through this door and then just down at the end of the hallway. There are groups for kids. If you want to get to know members of our church better, let's do it in a study. And also, I know we haven't been doing this regularly. We're beginning up again our Bible Basics lunch. Some people call it lunch with the preacher. The reason we do that is if you have any questions about who we are as a church, or as a congregation, if you have any questions about the Bible, if you have any questions about life, period, we get together after church on Sundays, not an extravagant lunch. We make sandwiches. Sometimes we'll have super chili, but it's too hot for that. But we gather together, we eat together, we fellowship together, and we get into God's Word together. And I want to invite you to come join us for that. A few prayer requests. Remind me of the name. Be in prayer for the family of Catherine Blansett. She passed away, is it this morning? Oh, on Monday. Be in prayer over that. There's several on our prayer list that just be in prayer over that. We're a church who believes in the power of prayer, and there are answers to prayer sitting within this congregation today. So please be in prayer over that family. Anything you could do to be an encouragement or a help to that family, we want to encourage you to do that as well. Put feet on your prayers if you can. So also, I just want to say, welcome back to the Answers to Prayer sitting in the room today. So I'm glad y'all are here. So that being said, we have a Bible verse. If you'll stand with us, we'll read that and then we'll pray. I know I like to shake it up. Sometimes I'll do it before, sometimes I'll do it after. But we're going to read from Acts 2:42. It says, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers." Heavenly Father, we are just grateful to be in your house today. Let me back that up, Lord. We're grateful to be your house today. This building and all others like it, that's not your dwelling place. Your dwelling place is with us. It is in us through your Holy Spirit. We are the new temple being built up, stones being built in, as Peter says, Lord. Help us as we go, Lord, as we walked into this place, to leave it different than when we walked out. Produce within us, Lord, through your Son, Jesus Christ, rivers of living water that will flow out. Help us to be a church that moves, Lord, to be a church that is the hands and feet of Christ, a church that stands upon the gospel, that we can't do it on our own, but that Jesus Christ did in living and in dying on the cross in our place, in rising again, and Lord, who is seated at your right hand, and we're waiting for him to come back. And while we're waiting, Lord, let us be a church on a mission, that it's not about filling pews, it's about getting people to Jesus Christ. You're the only one who can fix the mess we're in, the personal and the global, Lord. And Father, I thank you, lastly, that nothing surprises you. We might look at the world around us and panic, but there are no emergencies where you're at, only plans. That though the chaos is all around, you're still seated on the throne immovably. We thank you, Father, for who you are. We love you, God. And we lift all this up. May our worship be pleasing to you. In Jesus' almighty name, amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet. Was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. Yeah, he bathed my heart in love, and woke my world up. Just a little talk with Jesus makes me right. Well, let us have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about our troubles. We'll hear our famous cry. He'll answer by and by. Now a little prayer will turn him. And no little fire is burning. We'll find a little talk with Jesus makes you right. Sometimes my past seems dream without a ray of cheer. Hide the light of day. Oh, the mist of sin may rise and hide the starry sky. And just a little talk with Jesus clears the way. Well, let us have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about our troubles. He will hear our faintest cry. He'll answer by and by. Now a fire is burning. The fine little talk with Jesus makes you right. Well, I may have doubts and fears. My eyes are filled with tears. And Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. When I go to him in prayer, he knows my every care. And just a little talk with Jesus. Well, let us have a little talk with Jesus. tell him all about our trouble. You hear our famous cry, he'll answer by and by. Your little prayer will turn him, you know, little fire is burning. A fine little talk with Jesus makes you right. Well, let us have a little talk with Jesus, tell him all about our trouble. He'll hear our famous cry, he'll answer by and by.
The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 5, it says, as you enter the house of God, keep your ears open and your mouth shut. It's evil to make mindless offerings to God. Don't make rash promises and don't be hasty in bringing matters before God. After all, God is in heaven and you are here on earth, so let your words be few. Too much activity gives you restless dreams, and too many words makes you a fool. When you make promises to God, don't delay in following through, for God takes no pleasure in fools. Keep all the promises you make to him. It's better to say nothing than to make a promise and not keep it. Amen. Don't let your mouth make you sin. And don't defend yourself by telling the temple messenger that the promises you made was a mistake. That would make God angry, and he might wipe out everything you have achieved. Talk is cheap, like daydreams and other useless activities. Fear God instead.
Amen.
How many times do we tell God something and don't follow through with it? Mm-hmm. We sang that song, Just a Little Talk with Jesus Makes It Right. But what we don't follow through with is just a little talk with Jesus and a change on our part makes it right.
Amen.
Amen. Because if we don't change to become more like him, then we're just going to have the same issues. If you haven't read the book of Ecclesiastes, by the way, don't do it unless, if you're going through, you know, a depression or a sadness, because it's just going to make it worse. Get in the right gear, my Lord.
Thank you.
time. That third verse just gets me. We're going to do it a little bit a cappella. Here we go.
My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear.
You see, Brother Wes, they made me swallow my pride this morning. They put a speaker where I wouldn't have to come up the old man lane, but I couldn't get through. So they forced me this morning. Hey, one thing I'd like to start out with is, you remember Sermon Brother Matt bought last week about comfort zone, being comfortable. What I'm trying to bring up is this morning that we got a text about the through driveway. And my first thought was, somebody's going to have to go in the church different. Will they still show up? Or will they decide, I can't go in this way, so I can't come to church? But it looks like everybody came. It's a blessing that you're here. Now then, let me get to what I'm supposed to do. If I walked up to you on the street and I asked you, what is your greatest blessing? Don't answer. But for the past 3 weeks, that's what I've been doing. From Hot Springs to Texarkana. Nobody's run from me yet, so it hasn't got out. But I have walked up to some people I knew, some I didn't, and I just asked them, what is your greatest blessing? Family was the first answer, mostly. Health was second. And then money and jobs was third. And it troubled me for a while. No one said Jesus. Finally, I came up on 3 people. I know it was over 100, 150 that I spoke to, but finally, 3 people told me Jesus. And they got me to studying or pondering. We place so much emphasis on this world, the blessings that we see, we think, are our greatest blessing. But when you read the book, your greatest blessing is Jesus Christ. You can't see him. I say the Holy Spirit, you can feel him. But it just struck me that everyone kind of lingered, went that way. So I looked up in dictionary. Or I got on, I don't know, I has a dictionary, I got on my phone. And I looked up, what is grateful? It says, showing appreciation of kindness and thankfulness. Well, as most generations, as you have your children, what do we teach them? We teach them to say thank you if someone gives them a gift. We're taught at such a small age to be thankful and appreciative. But as we grow older, do we remain that way? Going by the greatest blessings, I don't know. But the scripture I want to pass out to you this morning is in Luke. It's about the 10 lepers. Let me read a small portion of it. While Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, he was passing between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered the village, 10 leprous men who stood at a distance met him. They raised their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, Jesus' words, "Go and show yourselves to the priest." As they were going, they were cleansed. Now one of them, when he saw that he had been healed, he turned back, glorifying God. He fell on his face at his feet, giving thanks to him, and he was a Samaritan. But we know the story with the Jews and the Samaritan. My question to you is this morning, I don't know how you answered my question, but do we do that to Jesus in our lives? Do we come to him in need? Do we pray heartily? We ask God, or Jesus, I need. When we receive that need and we're joyful, do you turn your back and don't be thankful? Do you walk away until the next time you need and you're back into Jesus? So as we come around this table, I ask you, examine your heart. Would you be one of the 9 that eased away and forgot to come back to Jesus and thank him? Or would we be like the Samaritan and fall at his feet and be truly thankful for what he's done for us? Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today so joyful we can gather in your in the presence of each one of us. Father, we can gather with the right thing in our mind to worship you. Father, you come to when we come to you, your arms are open wide. You take us broken, beat down, whatever. You don't ask us to be perfect to come unto you. You wrap your arms around us. We accept you, and we become a new creation. We become a new man to walk, Father. Now that we are preparing ourselves to partake of these emblems, let us remember that Jesus is Christ on the tree for us. Let the bread be his body that's broken, and may the juice be the blood that was shed. But we know, Father, that our eternal hope is in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Matthew 26, verse 26 says, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took a cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. And we're reminded by the Apostle Paul that whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. All God's people said, amen. It's good to see you again, buddy. I'm glad you're back. Well, I'm glad you're here. I just want you to know that. All right, so for those who may not know, if you see kids moving forward, we do this just about every Sunday. I'm going to tell you, you get some sound doctrine coming from this front pew.
Yeah!
Not attention seeking, though, all right? We get some, I mean, like, I'm always reminded by you guys. When asked who the greatest in the kingdom was, you know what Jesus did? He did that later. But when Jesus was asked by his disciples who the greatest in the kingdom was, he took a small child and put him right in front of him and said, if you want to be great in the kingdom, be like this. Do you know why Jesus said that? Anyone have a guess? Why would Jesus say, be like a kid if you want to be great in this kingdom? Why would Jesus say that? Because we're kids. You answered the question with the question. Okay. So why would Jesus say that?
So he believes in kids a lot, so he could just be like, kids are like childish, they could be good rulers, they could be like, I want you to do my chores for me, like the dishes.
That doesn't sound like a good ruler to me, but I like that you're thinking. Yes, sir. Jesus wants us to be able to be like him so we could glorify him and do the things he wants us to do. How old are you? This many. Yes, sir. I'll come down the line, I promise. What? Not earthly.
Authority.
Not earthly.
Like him.
Godly men and women. He wants us to become godly men and women, yes. He wants us to be like children because children trust easier. What's that verse say? Out of the mouths of babes? I love it. Yes, ma'am. So he wants us to trust him the way you guys trust your teachers, your parents, and the authorities in your life. Did you have your hand up? Yes, ma'am. He took your answer? Well, your brothers, so it's genetic. Go ahead. It's okay. Miss Emily, that happens to me all the time, and it gets worse. She goes, it was in my head, but it's not there anymore. All right, let's talk real quick. Hands down. But that's all right. He wants us to glorify his name. And he wants us to trust him completely. Like yesterday, one of you guys in this front row stayed with me all day. Did you trust me?
No.
You did, didn't you? Stay with me all day because his mama and daddy had something to do. And he trusted me. He may not have liked everything that I did because I made him eat 2 bites of mac and cheese. He's like, but kids are often more trusting than adults, true or false? And Jesus calls that young child in front of everybody because he says, like this child trusts God, you trust God. And as adults, let's face it, we put our own tack on that. Well, I trust God, but this wise woman of God at the last church I served at said,
Brian, whenever you put that word but in a sentence, it erases everything in front of it. I trust God, but I like my traditions. I trust God, but if I follow God, what's going to become of my 401k? My bottom line? Who's going to pay my bill? What's going to?
You.
Obviously, if we're saying, but if I say I trust God, we're not what? Trusting God. What is 401k? We'll talk about it later. I actually want to talk about it much later with you. I don't want you to worry about it yet. But here's the fact. God wants us to trust Him. And when He says go, what does He want us to do?
Go.
When He says speak, what does He want us to do?
Speak.
When He says wait, what does He want us to do?
Wait.
So today, when you're going to go to your class, are you leading? You're going to go with Miss Michaeline. I want you to learn to just trust God and take Him at His word. All right? Love y'all. Whew. Like about half that much energy, I'd do okay. All right. Well, we're in Acts. And I've called this series for a reason. So Jesus is risen, now what? Church, I say it this way because as kids, we play games like Simon Says. And I mentioned this last week, but I think it's absolutely 100% true and worth repeating. When Simon says, touch your head, what do? There's like three people every service that win the game. Everybody else is out. Simon says, touch your head, what do? Jesus says, go, we talk about it. Let that sit for a minute. Simon says, touch our head, we touch our head. Jesus says, go, we talk about it. And I'm going to tell you what, I don't care if you're 8 years old or 88 or 188 years old or feel like it. If you're still sucking air and you're a follower of Christ, you have work to do. And sometimes the work is to wait. Sometimes the work is to be patient and wait on God. That was the work that Jesus gave them last week in Acts chapter 1, right? Go and wait. Hurry up and wait. In our society, the more modern we become, waiting becomes a taboo almost. Let's think about it. We have fast food, but fast food's not good enough. We did this yesterday. There's an app, so you order ahead so you don't have to wait. Everything we have in our modern secular culture is built around one thing, convenience. What is good for me? We have social media, but I'm going to tell you, it's some of the most antisocial things I've ever seen. It makes us more self-appreciative. I'm going to tell you, as Christians and followers of Christ, we shouldn't be seeking self. The Bible talks nothing about self-care. I'm going to tell you that. Yes, we should eat healthy. You're going to be like, what about Daniel who wanted to only eat vegetables? That's a different subject altogether. We'll get into a theological debate about it if you want to. Let's talk about it after church. I invited you to lunch. The Bible does not talk about self-care. It talks about trust in God. The more I seek after myself, the worse of a person I become. And I'm going to tell you, when I stand before Christ Jesus and I approach Him and someday and I stand before the Father at the judgment seat, and if I approach Christ with anything else but what Jesus did for me, I'm done. I'm gone. Forever. The work of the cross has nothing to do with you apart from one simple fact. I put Jesus on the cross. I did. You put Jesus on the cross. Why? Because Jesus died for our rebellion. That's what sin is in a nutshell. Everything we do outside the will of God. I don't care how good you think it is. And this is the message that the world needs to hear. But in an age of convenience, we don't want to be inconvenienced. True or false?
I don't want to talk to someone because it might ruin the relationship. I don't want to speak the truth of God because, let's just face it, that's not the way society moves anymore. Jesus would never have his disciples stand on a street corner and preach. I'm going to tell you something. Anybody who says those things either has not read the Bible or is outright denying it. Paul was shipwrecked 3 times. He was given lashes several times. He was stoned at least once. He was put in prison multiple times. What apart from getting to serve Christ seems anything about that situation about Paul's comfort? And on the very first day of church, which is what we're going to study today, it had nothing to do with comfort. It had everything to do with God's glory and seeking out this lost generation. Church, I know today is a scary day to live in. We're seeing what's going on in Israel right now. We're seeing what's going on in the deterioration of our country and its morals and values. But I'm going to tell you what, God is not surprised by a single bit of it. God had a plan and a purpose. And guess what? The plan was you. Because if you have been saved, yes, I said it, then your job is to be the light in the world, the salt of the earth, and go out and tell other people for the hope you have. Your job's not to convert people. Your job's not to convict people. That's the Word of God and the Holy Spirit's job. Your job is to tell people. I loved how Spurgeon put it. Until I get the roll up yonder, I'll preach whosoever will. And I hate to burst your bubble if this is what you're thinking, because you might say, well, preacher, I don't have the gift of evangelism. Good, nobody did. Evangelism isn't a gift, it's a command. Jesus told his disciples, go and make disciples. And guess what? You're disciples of those disciples of those disciples traced all the way back 2,000 years. Your role is the same as theirs, to go and make disciples. Why? Just as Steve said today, we have hope. We have been cured of something far greater than leprosy. We have been given eternity. This physical body, if the Lord tarries, shall wear out, but your soul shall move on. Where is it going? That's the question we should always be asking. And so our role in life, follower of Christ, is not to make our comfort in this life better, but to look forward to and point others to the next. So if you will, please stand with me as we read God's Word. It says, when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together, this is Acts chapter 2, verse 1, in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues of fire appeared to them and rested on, listen to this, not 11 of them, not 12 of them, each one of them. How many was that church? 120 individuals. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them utterances. And all God's people said, amen. Please be seated. Let's break this down for a minute. Could you imagine being told to wait and then waiting? And the day of Pentecost, which is, again, my facts are all jumbled. I believe it's 40 days after Passover, 50 days. And it's literally a feast in which all the people of God were told to gather together near the temple to make the right offerings and sacrifices. It was a celebration. And here they are. They're still waiting. It has been now almost a month and a half since Jesus rose from the dead. I don't know about y'all, but in our age of convenience, I'd be saying, now what? I don't like sitting still.
And pray for my wife because she gave us four boys who are exactly like me. And yesterday I had two more boys added to that list who are exactly like that. So she was probably run a little bit ragged by the end of the day. We don't like sitting still. And yet God said, wait. And they said, what are we waiting for? And Jesus is like, I'll give you a sign. Now I'm going to tell you, we got to break this down. There's a lot going on here. So, I hope we're going to get through Acts chapter 2 today. We might not. But I want you to understand something very important. The disciples had already received the Holy Spirit. The apostles at least had. How do I know? Jesus appeared to them and breathed on them and they received the Holy Spirit. That's what the Gospels say. This was a little bit different. This was the Holy Spirit coming in power. And this is a callback. We've got to read the whole of Scripture. There are certain preachers who say we need to unhitch the Old Testament. If you don't read the book of Ezekiel, you may not understand what's going on here. In the valley of dry bones, Ezekiel had this vision. There was this valley full of just these bones, and it was bare, and it was dry and barren. And God asked him, Son of man, can these bones live again? And Ezekiel goes, oh, Lord, only you know. And all of a sudden, the bones started snapping together, and sinew was growing on them, and skin, and it became a mighty army, but they were still dead. And all of a sudden, this rushing wind comes over them, and they have life. Do you hear the significance of that? Loved ones, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 says, we are dead in our sins. I'm going to read that to you. It's not on the board, but Ephesians chapter 2, listen to this. And we might understand why this rushing wind was so important. God never throws anything away. He doesn't do things randomly. It's all on purpose, in accordance with the Scripture, in accordance to His plan. That's why I'm going to tell you, if God ever gives you a word and it's not in the Bible, God didn't speak to you. God verifies and bears witness to Himself again and again and again. Listen to this. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, oh, I love those words. It erases everything in front of it. Being rich in mercy because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with Him and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages He might show the immeasurable riches of His grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Wow. See, they were already reformed. They were. He restored them. He reconciled them. But yet they had to wait because while they had the Holy Spirit had not come in power. That's what Jesus said at the beginning of the book. He will come upon you in power. And that rushing wind was exactly what Ezekiel saw. The dry bones were there. The dry bones in the vision is Israel. And Israel had a form of godliness, but they were more concerned with their religiosity and their tradition. Jesus even said, when they asked him, well, why do you allow your disciples to forsake the tradition of the elders? And he said, why do you forsake the word of God for your traditions? They had an appearance of being alive, just as a corpse might if it's still fresh. Just as those unformed bodies that Ezekiel saw might have had when they had flesh. It wasn't until the breath came upon them in power that they were living. And here on that day in Pentecost, they fully came alive. Why? Because the presence of God manifested Himself, not just in them, but around them. Everyone in that upper room, all 120, not just merely the men, but the women also. had tongues of fire appear over them. The wind rushed over them. They were seeing the work of the Holy Spirit in them. And all of them began speaking. By the way, this word tongues that we see in most of our modern translations, literally in this terms, other languages. Scripture will confirm that in a few verses. This is something that is significant also. Why did they speak in other languages? Again, we got to go back in Scripture. You go to Genesis. After the flood, everybody still stayed together. What did God tell them? Be fruitful and multiply and go throughout the whole earth. But they stayed together and they built something. Anyone know what it was? Babel. Oh, I heard someone even before I asked. She's like, Babel, Babel. I love it. Participate, church. They built the Tower of Babel. Why? As a monument to themselves. Because look, we invented a brick. God's like, great, I invented the materials to make the brick. They built a city and a monument around themselves, and instead of obeying the voice of God, they obeyed their own whims and glorified themselves, trying to reach up to heaven to meet with God and put their own throne next to His. It doesn't work that way, church. But on the day of Pentecost, when people were from all over, there were Cushites, and if you don't know where Cush is, it's Ethiopia. There were Arabs. There were Greeks and Medes and Persians. There were people from all over the Roman Empire. We'll see in a few verses, it's from all over the known world. Jews and proselytes from every walk of life. God doesn't throw things away. And just like on the Tower of Babel, when God said, let us go down and confuse their language, by the Holy Spirit, the curse was reversed. God wanted all people united, not under themselves and their abilities, but under Christ Jesus. And so when we're reading on, let's continue on in the next verse, verse 5. As they're going on, there were dwelling in Jerusalem devout men from every, or Jews, and devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together. Imagine that. Out here, you hear a big boom, you're either sure someone's blowing up Tannerite, or a transformer's exploded. But there, could you imagine that day? You're sitting there in town, you're bringing your worship or your sacrifice or your offering to the temple to celebrate the feast. You're getting ready to eat because God loved to celebrate. I'm surprised if you look at the Old Testament feasts, they got any work done. And all of a sudden you hear, not a boom, but this wind. And it's, I don't know about y'all, but I've never seen a wind localized in one spot. And the sound was so great, it drew everybody there. People were wondering what was going on. They went to this house where the apostles all of a sudden and the church there were speaking in other languages. What were they speaking? They were proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. And here's what the gospel is. I'm going to go to another verse really quick before we get there. 1 Corinthians 15. I've read this before, but Romans 1 Chapter 16 says, Romans 1, verse 16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God to salvation for those who believe. I'm going to read the gospel to you. And here's what it says. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I deliver to you as a matter of first importance. That's how I know what they were proclaiming. It's the matter of first importance. What I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that He was buried and that He was raised on the third day. Listen to this again, in accordance to the Scriptures. And that He appeared to Cephas and the 12. He appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom were still alive, though some had fallen asleep. Then He appeared to James, that's the brother of Christ, and then all the apostles. And lastly, as one untimely born, He appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. The gospel, church, is this. We are sinners who are separated by our sin from our God, who invented us and designed us and put us in his image. Our sin destroys the relationship. But God, being rich in mercy, sent his son Jesus while we were enemies. I know I'm stringing pearls here together, several verses all at once. Jesus did it, I could do it too. While we were yet enemies, sent his son to die for us, the ungodly. He did this in accordance with the scriptures. God said it, he did it. God always fulfills what he says he's going to do. Jesus Christ was crucified, he was buried, and on the third day rose again, once and for all, dealing with the matter. Sin has no power over us. Death has no hold on us. How do I know they were proclaiming this? Because this is the central message of all of Scripture. We are sinners, desperately lost, but God. It says, at the sound, the multitude gathered together, verse 6, and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. Could you imagine that? You're from Ethiopia, or you're from Rome, or you're from wherever else, Spain, wherever else they may have been from. And here they are, all these Hebrew-speaking Jews, who probably knew some Greek because that was the common language of the day, but they're all sitting there. They're not just merely preaching in Hebrew and Greek. They are preaching in every known language that was there in the moment. That's wild. Some want to attest this to what's called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I don't want to get into that argument. What I want to say is God does everything for his purpose, for his glory. And the idea is never to draw attention upon ourselves, but to draw attention always to Christ and him crucified and risen again. So when God does something like this, it's a moment for us to pay attention and listen. How often do we do that? Who here in the last week has received an answer to prayer? Now I'm going to ask this question, a follow-up. Who here has been too busy to notice? Because I'm going to tell you, every one of you this week have received an answer to prayer, whether it was what you wanted or in the way you wanted it or not. But we get so caught up in the moment of convenience that we're looking for big signs like a mighty rushing wind and people speaking in our language. The fact is, God is working, God is moving, and God is trying to get our attention, but we're just too busy to notice. And right now, if you claim to have Christ, he's not going to send a rushing wind after you. He's going to send his word after you, and he's going to try and send people in your life that he wants you to speak to, but you've got to decide whether you're too busy, you're being inconvenienced, or you're loving yourself too much to risk a relationship to tell people that they are dying or are dead already. The 120 in the upper room did what Christ said and waited. And when he gave them the sign, they spoke and acted. Loved ones, we've got the sign. There is a cross where we have had our sins crucified and an empty tomb confessing that there is a God who cares for his children enough to send his own son to reconcile us by his life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. What are you waiting for? Why do we want to wait for a giant sign when there's people who are dead right across the street from us, next to us, in our own homes, maybe even in here? It goes on, verse 7, they were amazed and astonished, saying, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in his own native language, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia? By the way, that Asia is not the Asia we mark. It's the area around Turkey and outside of Macedonia and all that. It's called Asia Minor. That was part of the extent. Goes on, Phrygia and Pamphylia Egypt and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others mocking said, they're filled with new wine. In other words, they're drunk. Interestingly, when I was a kid and I was a little bit more of a heathen than I am now, I say kid, I was 18 years old. I used to go play pool after school and after work. And there was a bar attached, and since I wasn't 21, I wasn't allowed in there. But I remember like all the guys who thought they could speak other languages after they'd been drinking more than a few. I've never seen anyone who's drunk speak another language legitimately. I lived in an area where there was, you know, various Asian cultures and Hispanic cultures and all sorts of stuff. Like we had people, you know, from Samoa and all sorts of stuff. I mean, we were kind of a big melting pot. I remember one guy, and for some reason he took a shine to me. I remember him looking at a Samoan fella, and he just spoke the biggest gibberish you could ever think of. He goes, what I say? The guy goes, brother, I don't know. That's never happened that I've seen where somebody has gotten intoxicated and spoken a new language. And that's the accusation that was being leveled against the new church. And here's why. Because people who genuinely see an act of God and yet do not want to participate will do everything they can to find a way out. I'm going to tell you, most atheists are intellectual atheists. The reason I say that is the universe is too fine-tuned to say that there's no creation behind it. The definition of nothing is no thing. So for someone to say no thing created everything is ludicrous. The fact that we exist, the second law of thermodynamics, I don't quite understand it, I'm not a physicist, but I understand this much, states that everything deteriorates over time. So how in the world can a supposed single-cell organism create something complex? It can't. There is no creation agent. And what's more, in the 41 years I've walked on this earth, I've never seen non-life create life. The reason most people act as if some of those scoffers did on that day is because they don't want to believe. They don't want to believe. Why? Because if I believe in God, I am now suddenly accountable for everything I've ever done. And the majority of us, and I'm going to include myself in this, we would much prefer to be God than bow down to the sovereign Lord. So the reason I say all this, church, is we've got to understand this. The reason why we're called to go out into a world that's hostile and speak the truth, even though they're going to still respond that way, is because there's somebody who needs to hear it. This is what I mean. In verse 14, it says, Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed the men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem. Let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. I'm going to pause here for a minute. This is the very first sermon on the very first day of church, and Peter opened up with a joke. It's okay for a preacher to tell a joke. We can't be drunk. It's only 9 o'clock. Literally the translation into modern English. It's okay to have a sense of humor about your faith. And it's okay to address mockers and scoffers with humor. Why? Because humor disarms things. Jesus was a funny guy. Most of the time we read it in Scripture and we kind of have a wooden way of it. But I could just imagine what Jesus was saying when he says, why do you look at the speck of dust in your brother's eye when there is literally a tree growing out of yours? I find that humorous. Jesus is saying, you're going around with this tree growing out of your eye saying, brother, you got something right there. Have a sense of humor about your faith. Be joyful in your faith. Stop acting like you got baptized in vinegar. Don't sing about the joy of the Lord looking like a raisin. It's okay to address people where they're at. The Apostle Paul, wandering through Athens, we'll get down to this someday, walked around Athens, looked at all the statues and the sanctuaries for all the various gods. He got to know the culture, so much so that when he was in front of their Institute of Higher Learning, the Areopagus, where everybody gathered together and spoke nothing but philosophy, he quoted one of their own Epicurean poets. Get to know people where they are at, so that someday we can bring them to where we are at. What did Paul say? To the Jew, I became as the Jews so that I might win some Jews. To the Greeks, I became as the Greeks so that I might win some Greeks. To the strong, I became as the strong. To the weak, I became as the weak. To those outside the law, to the outlaws. There weren't one percenters back then, but there were people of the same kind. I became as an outlaw, though I did not myself violate the law. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I am free under Christ. I became all things to all men, that by all means I might save some. And the God Paul served is exactly that way. How do I know? His son put on human flesh and was one of us. Though not like one of us. Know who you're speaking to. Do what it takes without violating God's laws or principles to reach them. Why? Because there's a world that is dead that needs life. He goes on, for these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. But this was what was uttered through the prophet Joel. You see what he did? He took a joke and then he brought it right into Scripture. Some of y'all know me. We have this conversation. You ask me something, I'm going to answer it from a biblical perspective and I'm going to use Scripture. He tied in what everybody witnessed with their own eyes with Scripture. And what he quotes is from Joel. It says, and in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. I used to be a young man, but now I have a lot of dreams. Them's the jokes, folks. I want to address this little conversation too. You might notice I jump in Scripture to Scripture, but I do so because there's a lot of deliberation throughout Scripture. In 2 Peter chapter 3, Paul says, in the last days, Peter, who wrote Peter, says, scoffers will continue scoffing. But God is patient with you, not wanting that any man should boast. The last days are not what we think they are. Many of us are looking at signs and wonders. Some of us are looking at Iran and we're freaking out and you're hoping I'm going to address it. Here's how I address it. Get to work. There's work to be done. I'm not scared of what's going on. As a matter of fact, if they come tomorrow and they chain the doors and they arrest me, I've always wanted to start a prison ministry. If they beat me and take away my house and everything that I have, it all belonged to God anyway. I hope somebody will be blessed by it. And should they take my life, I get to go home early. Loved ones, the reason we exist is because the glory of God needs to manifest itself in us. And we are in the last days, and the Spirit of God has poured out. And if the Spirit of God dwells in you, which Scripture says it does, what are you waiting for? I want you to listen to this again. I'm going to read it again. I will pour out my Spirit. Listen, he doesn't say on the nation of Israel. On all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And even on my male slaves and female slaves. That's what the word servants means. In those days I will pour out my Spirit and they will prophesy. God's using strict hyperbole here. Hyperbole. To tell us that it doesn't matter what your estate is. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter how much power you have. It doesn't matter if you're old or young, healthy or sick. If the Spirit of God is on you, He expects you to do something with it. We're not here to pat ourselves on the back. I heard a quote this week that was so great. And I don't know who the speaker was, but he said 99.9% of the church doesn't have fellowship with God. They have fellowship with each other about God. If we have fellowship with God, then why do we worry about the things of this world, church? And I'm speaking to you as a father of four young boys. Because I know some of you are like, well, what about my kids? What happens if something happens to me? Do you trust God to deal with that? Because the same God who's brought me this far will handle them if I'm gone. What about your wife? If God decides to take me before he takes her, she'll be okay. God will handle it. I'm going to trust God with that. Well, what about your finances? You know what? I've never really had any. God's provided. I'm going to trust him with that. You name it, I'm going to trust God with it. Why? Because God has poured his spirit upon me, and if you staple my lips shut, it'll leak out my ears. You should know if you follow me on social media, the only thing I really post on there, things that glorify God and try and draw people to him. You talk to me in public. You ask for prayer in Dollar General, even though they still got all the stock out. We'll block an aisle and pray. You have a question, night or day. Some of y'all have texted me at odd hours, and you know I'm going to respond. Why? Because the Spirit of God is in me, and I want you to go where I'm going, and I'm going to fight for you, and I'm going to strive for you on my knees in prayer, and I'm going to seek after what's best, and I pray for every one of you by name. I really do. And if I don't know you, I've been praying for you anyways, because I said, Lord, send us some folks to preach the gospel to. Everything that I have, because the Spirit of God is on me, is for the works of God. It goes on in verse 19, he says, and I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood. By the way, did you know the moon's resting? It's turning red. It's almost like God knows what's going on. Before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Again, you ask how I knew they were speaking the gospel in other languages. Peter comes out and says it. Loved ones, this is our holy mandate. Who here has a friend that's unsaved? Who here has a family member that's unsaved? Who here has a neighbor that's unsaved? Now here's the hard one. Who here has an enemy that's unsaved? Guess what? God has you. He wants them. And the Apostle Paul in Romans, quoting Isaiah, says, how will they know unless someone tells them? And I want to give you this challenge, church. Pray for the boldness of Peter and the apostles and the 120 in the upper room. Because at the end of the day, when I stand before God and I receive whatever I get, I don't want to see someone standing in line saying, he didn't tell me. I pray that you don't want that either. So I'm going to go and proclaim the gospel. My role is not to convince and convict. That's the Scripture and the Holy Spirit's job. But I'm going to go proclaim. Verse 22, he goes on, men of Israel, hear these words. You hear how he's tying Joel in now to the modern stuff. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. See, he's giving them knowledge they know. You know what's interesting? We may not have seen Jesus face to face, but it's interesting that atheists like Richard Dawkins are now calling themselves cultural Christians. Why? Because they don't want to believe in God, but they want to recognize all the good that Christians and Christianity has brought to the world. The reason we have Western civilization, in spite of people trying to overthrow it, the reason why slavery was abolished, by and large, in most of the world, it still exists in others, pray against it. Was it because people, yes, some people justified themselves with the Bible, but by and large, people saw God and the sufferings of their fellow men, and stood up and said something. We are called for this time and this place that we are in. They knew Jesus. They saw his works. There were people who were probably in that audience who had received sight or had been healed or things like that. Everybody in Judea and Jerusalem at that point probably had somebody they knew that was affected by Jesus personally. And I'm going to tell you what, church, It's still the same thing today. Everybody, not everybody in the world, because the gospel still needs to go to some places, but everybody you knows somebody, if they know you, who's been affected by Jesus personally. Use what God has given you to spread His glory everywhere. He goes on, this Jesus, verse 23, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. We can still use that today. I crucified Christ. You crucified Christ. How? We didn't deliver him up personally. But I'll tell you what, if I was to stand before God on my own, carrying all the weight of my sin, in front of the righteous judge, I'd be done. I'd be gone. But God, on His own Son, laid my sin. Jesus carried my sin into eternity. And when He stood before the righteous judge, He Himself was righteous. So my sin no longer has value. It's as worthless as Bitcoin. If you trade in Bitcoin, I'm sorry. Loved ones, if He did that for me, I want Him to do it for even the worst person I know. And I crucified Christ. Verse 24 says, but God raised Him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for Him to be held by it. Why? Because it says in Scripture, again, we've got to go. You see how many Scriptures are just coming out of just the few verses we read? The penalty for sin is death. So, church, if the penalty for sin is death, why couldn't death hold Jesus? Because He was perfect. Because He was able to do it. And so I'm standing here before you today on a platform that I don't deserve to be on because Jesus did it. I am free. Isn't that worth telling? Isn't that worth risking over? Isn't that worth dying for? Because if I die, I go home. And if I live, more people know. I quoted Richard Wurmbrand last week. Anybody who knows of the Voice of the Martyrs Ministries, he's the founder of it. He was a Jew that came to faith in Christ right before the Nazis took over Romania. And then as the Nazis were in Romania and the Russians were coming in, they were actually hiding some of their enemies who were hunting for them and preaching the gospel to them there. And then, standing up in a summit of all the priests and preachers in Romania with Joseph Stalin present, he embarrassed Joseph Stalin on live radio that was being broadcast to the rest of the world. So he was arrested. He was imprisoned and tortured for 14 years. And when he came out, he had this to say. It was my pleasure to preach the gospel, but in prison, if I preached the gospel, they'd beat us. So we would be happy to preach the gospel, and they would be happy to beat us, and everybody was happy. Loved ones, is your joy Christ? What are you holding back? What are you not willing to lose? And that's the thing that's your God. Proclaim this, that if death has no hold on Christ, if I have been set free by Christ, death no longer has hold on me either. If I die, if this tent wears out, if my body is done, my spirit is with Him. In Ephesians, we read this, that chapter in Ephesians 2, we read this with the kids this morning. Our spirits are already sealed away with Him. So it's just a transition. It's a breath in this life. And then a breath in that. Verse 25 says, for David says concerning Him, I saw the Lord always before me, for He is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope, for You will not abandon my soul to Hades. See Him tying Scripture in with that. Or let Your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with Your presence. David goes on to exposit on this. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God. That's Daniel. We've spoken to that before. And if you haven't been here, come see me after. We'll have lunch and talk about it. Being seated at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Peter is saying all of Scripture points towards Christ. David points towards Christ. The prophets point towards Christ. The law points towards Christ. The reason I'm not going to unhitch myself from the Old Testament is because it all points to Jesus. The reason I'm going to live in the New Testament while being in the Old Testament is it all points back. And you and I, church, are supposed to be testaments of Christ. May everything we do point to this Jesus who gave himself up for us. Now, I'm going to say this. Every act of the Spirit requires a response. Every sermon you hear on a Sunday, every conversation you have Monday through Saturday, and even Sunday afternoons, it requires a response. You're either going to be changed by the Word of God, or you're going to continue living as you are. You have to decide what you're going to do with it. And these people here responded to the Spirit. Listen to what it says. Verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were... What does it say, church? They were what? Cut to the heart. Was it Peter's dynamic speaking? Nope. It was Scripture and the Holy Spirit speaking about who? Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tell you what, in this church, and the elders have affirmed this over and again, we are not going to cater to modern sensibilities. We will not bow down to Caesar. We are not going to change the message if it's going to offend somebody. I pray you are offended by holy things. Why? Because if you're offended, offense causes us to change. The reason so many young men and women are out on the streets being offended is because they do rightly recognize things are wrong, but they are wrongly pointed in the direction that is opposite of towards what is right. If we weren't offended, nothing would ever get done. And so, church, Peter preached an offensive message. And those who had heard were cut to their heart. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Loved ones, my prayer for you every Sunday is this should be your plea. What shall I do? We hear something from God's word. I'm going to tell you, test everything I say against it. And if I'm wrong, tell me, please. Hold me accountable to it. But if we hear God's word, our response shall always be, what shall we do? It should be. And if anything in your answer is short of full and complete surrender to Jesus Christ, it's the wrong answer. Verse 38 says, and Peter said to them, listen to these words. We don't preach this often enough. Well, I know we do here, but modern Christians, repent. And be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. That word repent was what John the Baptizer preached preceding Christ, and repent was what Jesus Christ preached. Repent was what Peter preached. Repent was what Paul preached. Repent was what Charles Spurgeon preached. Repent was what Billy Graham preached. Repent should still be what we preach. Repent and what? Be baptized. Now I'm going to tell you, We are baptized into Christ. But you can get dunked underwater every year at camp. I see that every year at camp, and I'm putting a plug for camp. Camp's coming up. But it's the finished work of Christ that leads us to baptism. Your confession does not save you. Though it says, those who confess Jesus is Lord shall be saved, it's not your confession. It's Christ that saves you. Your confession is that he saves you. When you're baptized into Christ, baptism is necessary. And Peter even writes in his letter, it is baptism that saves you. That's 1 Peter chapter 3. But we don't understand truly what he's saying half the time. We have seen people, even in my tenure here, get dunked underwater and never come back because they think they've completed the work. No. Baptism is the sealing of a covenant. For a covenant to be ratified, both parties need to make a sacrifice. Jesus made his, I need to make mine. Baptism is me. I'm crucifying myself, my flesh. Paul says, I have therefore crucified my flesh. I am being buried with Christ, and I am being raised again a new creation. Behold, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. I have to die that Christ may live in me. It's the sealing of the covenant. Are you sealed? Or are you just trying to escape hell? If you're trying to escape hell, you don't have Jesus. I'm going to tell you that. I am baptized because of Jesus. I want him. I desire him. I want him to dwell within me through his Holy Spirit. I want him to speak to me. I want so much of Jesus that, pardon the stupid joke, but I heard it and I liked it, and like any good preacher, I'm going to take it. I want to be so full of Jesus that a mosquito shall bite me singing, there's power in the blood flying away. Jesus himself, to fulfill all righteousness, was baptized. It's never been the issue. The issue is our hearts. Are you approaching Christ for selfish reasons, or are you cut to the heart? So if you're cut to the heart, I'm not asking you to get rebaptized today. But would you say, Lord, I've taken my life up again after giving it to you. I want to give it back. For the promise is for you, verse 39. And for your children, and for all who are far off, whom the Lord our God calls to himself. Say the message. You don't have to have a degree. I've got a degree, and I've had to unlearn everything I learned in Bible college. I've got to trust Christ. I've got to preach Christ. I've got to be like Paul, who says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. As a husband, I am taking care of God's daughter. As a father, I am raising God's sons. I have been born again, and therefore I am going to preach, repent, and be baptized, every one of you, for the forgiveness of your sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. But let's see how Peter thought about this later in life. I'm going to read that verse in 1 Peter 3. Maybe. There we go. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. Listen to this. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ as Lord, as holy. Always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. Now listen, here's where he gets down to brass tacks. For Christ also suffered once for our sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared. God was actually trying to give people a chance to repent. That's why it said he was patient. While the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through the water. Baptism, listen to this, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels and authorities and powers having been subjected to him. Peter preached this first sermon in one part of his life, and he was a lot older when he preached the second, and the message never changed. Repent. Be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. Receive the Holy Spirit, not just for you, for your kids, for your neighbors, for your coworkers, for your classmates, for everybody. He says, or verse 40 says, with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. First church was a megachurch. Nothing wrong with it if the preaching sound. And how did they continue to respond? Listen to this. They didn't merely get baptized, church. For them, everything changed. How do I know? Verse 42 follows verse 41. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers, and all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings, distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with gladness and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. How did they continue to respond after baptism? They devoted themselves. And what did the apostles teach? They taught Christ through the scriptures. And did they have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Shake your heads. No, they didn't. Did they have Romans through Jude? Shake your heads. No, they didn't. They didn't have Revelation. They searched the scriptures. They taught Christ through the scriptures. That was the apostles' teaching, the gospel through the scriptures. Are you devoted to the scriptures? They were devoted to the fellowship. Jesus said the greatest commandment was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. The church is not this building. The church is us. Are you devoted to each other? I'm going to tell you, I've got a long list of people I'm supposed to visit. And I'm so exhausted from all the visits I do, I don't have time for all of them. And I wish I did. I wish I could be all things everywhere all at once to all people. I'm not Jesus. I just serve him. But you're here. What are you doing? Are you devoted to others? They were devoted to the breaking of bread. Now, we go to the Lord's table every week. That was part of it. But Jesus was devoted to the breaking of bread. Did you know that? Before he gave us the Lord's Supper, most of his sermons and criticisms of the Pharisees and things like that was done around a supper table. The reason, in part, that we go to the Lord's table every week is there's intimacy when you have fellowship and eating together. We have fellowship with Christ and with one another. Jesus died to reconcile us to God and each other. Jesus says in Revelation 3:20, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and have a Bible study." Right? No. And what? Eat with him, and he with me. Eating together denotes intimacy. So the early church actually had intimacy with each other. We hold each other at arm's length. And sometimes we put on makeup and fancy clothes and we want to pretend at church like everything's okay. And inside we are screaming out for help. That didn't exist in the early church. Probably did, but not very often. But they also were devoted to this. There's actually, did you know, some scholars think that every time they gathered together, they actually had the Lord's Supper. You'd meet together with the church and then go and be with other church members, and they'd actually have the cup and the loaf out. Why? Because they wanted to honor Christ and have fellowship with him in all they did. They were devoted. The breaking of bread, and lastly, the prayers. Are you devoted to God's word? Are you devoted to fellowship, to breaking of bread and prayer? Loved ones, time's short. And day by day, as more scripture unfolds in front of our eyes and more Bible prophecies do, it's a reminder that time is short. Jesus told us of wars and rumors of wars and signs and wonders, not so that we would come and gather in a church house, but so that we would go out and tell people time is short. So are we waiting around as a matter of convenience, or are we seeking out Christ in all we do? As the elders and praise team come forward, I want to ask you, what are you doing? What are you doing with this? Are you dedicating your life to Christ? Are you dedicating yourself to the breaking of bread, the apostles' teaching, the prayers, the fellowship? Christ is risen. Go. Christ is risen. Love him and love each other. Christ is risen. Speak it everywhere. Let's not make it a matter of convenience. Let's seek Christ on his terms. We may be in his will and God will, and take several people with us. Today, if God has moved you in any way, I want to offer prayer. There's people who are going to be standing in the back if you need to pray, if you need someone to talk to. Because I know sometimes coming forward, I'm going to say it. I know, guess what? There weren't altar calls in Scripture as far as I could see. I know some of you have told me personally, you can't come forward because you just feel embarrassed. You feel eyes on you and you don't want that. That's fine. We have brothers and sisters who are willing to pray in the back most days. Elders and I are here for you. There's people in the aisles who'd be willing to talk to you. You've given your life up to Christ and tried to take it back. Join the club. I've done it more than I ought to. Once is more than I should have, but I've done it. There's no perfect people in heaven except for Christ. He takes our failures and he turns us into something beautiful. He'll give us beauty for ashes. You just have to trust him. You don't feel good enough or smart enough? Guess what? Join the club. I'm a dummy. That's why my God gave me a wonderful wife, because she tells me to shut up a lot. You don't have to be smart enough. You just have to be willing to go. Maybe you've never given your life to Christ. Every week, we've got that filled, and as far as I can try to remember, it's warm. Today it is. If you need to give your life to Christ, today's the day. But this invitation is not just for this song. During the song, God moves, you move. But most of y'all have my number, and if you don't, please ask. I always carry this around, and I give it to everybody I meet. It's business cards, not this thing. Some of you found out, I'll answer you at 10 o'clock at night if I have my phone on me. I want you to go where I'm going. I'm going to Jesus. Take every opportunity.
to get to Jesus. Every day, look for more Jesus. Every day, give glory to Jesus. Proclaim his goodness. And that's where we're at. That's all he asks. Just don't leave this place the same way you came in. If the Holy Spirit has so moved on you, go and move. And hopefully, by prayer and waiting, every day can be just like that first day of church. The Holy Spirit moving in power, not just in preachers or elders or deacons, but in everyone. Let's stand and worship him now. So before we close, I want to invite you again, if you want to, have lunch with us after church today. I'd love to get to know you better. I'd love to answer any questions you have. I worked with teenagers for many years, and I've realized there's no such thing as a stupid question, and I've answered some doozies. But I would love, you know, for you to come join us if you have questions about the church or about Scripture, about anything. Wednesday nights, I'm going to be leading a study 6 o'clock here in the fellowship hall. If you would like to be a part of that study, I've got some study guides. I'd love for you to read ahead and just be part of it. If you're interested, please come see me after church. I would love for you to participate in that. Choir practice tonight at 5. Choir practice. They need male voices. They press ganged, I think, my dad into it, so there would be 3 guys instead of 2 last time. We need male voices. If you're interested, something we'd love for you to be a part of. So there's lots to do.
There's lots of work to do. Let's get out and go do the work.
Yeah. Recapping Alan's group here tonight. Everybody here tonight at 6, choir practice. If you want to come early, you can come at 5. We'll be hanging out. Students going to Revive. Talk to Andrea about your student going. That's on April 28th. Community prayer night. Put that in your calendar for April 23rd, 7 p.m. in municipal building. Sunday, May 19th, the bridal shower for Grace Myers, 2 to 4 in the Fellowship Hall. They're registered at Caddo Antiques and Amazon.com. And then go ahead and get ready. You can holler at Andrea, because I know there's going to be tons of volunteers for VBS, right? Can I get a show of hands right now? Anyone? No? Yeah, there we are. I seen some of those hands. I see that. Okay. All right, let's reprise. We're going to reprise the Love Lifted Me chorus. But first, if we can get Brother Ronnie McKinnon, can you dismiss us? Let's do that. Love lifted me.